I am Dr. Rayappa. I am an ENT, head and neck and skull-based surgeon working at the Apollo Cancer Center, Chennai. Today, I'm going to talk about parotid gland tumors and how do we manage them. There are three pairs of major salivary glands and hundreds of minor salivary glands in the body. The major salivary glands are named as submandibular salivary gland, sublingual salivary gland, and the parotid gland. The submandibular gland is located beneath the lower jaw. Sublingual gland is located under the tongue. And the parotid gland is the largest one of all and is located in front and below the ear. The salivary glands produce saliva, which is essential for chewing the food, swallowing, and also helps in speech, and also it helps in digestion. Salivary gland tumors are rare, and they form about less than 10% of all head and neck tumors. Most of them, almost 80% of them, occur in the parotid gland. And of that, 75% of them are non-cancerous or benign. Although most of the tumors grow slowly, and with time they enlarge to bigger size, and sometimes they can turn malignant, that is cancer. Benign tumors present as a swelling in the cheek. They are slow growing, but they never stop growing. Over a period of years, they may become very large in size. If untreated, sometimes these tumors may enlarge deeper and narrow the space in the throat, causing difficulty in swallowing and also in breathing. Sudden increase in size of the swelling, pain, or facial paralysis or twitching in the face is an indication that the tumor has become malignant or it is arising as a malignant tumor. What causes parotid tumors? While most cancers in the head and neck are caused by excessive smoking and increased intake of alcohol, the parotid tumors are not related to these abuse of alcohol and smoking. We do not know the reason for these parotid tumors. How are these tumors diagnosed? If there is a suspicion that the patient has a parotid tumor, after clinical examination, we do CT scan or MRI to find out the extent of the tumor. Once we know the extent of the tumor, then we have to find out what kind of a tumor it is. So what we do is, we do what's called FNAC, which is fine needle aspiration cytology. In this method, we insert a small needle into the parotid tumor under local anesthesia and take out few cells from them and examine these cells under microscope, and the pathologist will be able to tell us whether the tumor is a benign tumor, that is non-cancerous tumor, or a cancerous tumor. Treatment for parotid gland tumors. Parotid gland tumors, whether it is cancer or non-cancer, is going to be surgery only. Before talking about the surgery, I want to talk a little bit about the anatomy for you to understand what is being done. The parotid gland, or the largest of the salivary glands, which is located in front of the ear and behind the lower jawbone, it secretes saliva. The saliva is taken by a small duct into the oral cavity. The most important structure we are concerned about in this surgery is the facial nerve, which controls the movement of the muscles of the facial expression. The facial nerve starts from the brain and travels through a small narrow bony canal in the ear, and then comes out of the skull base. Once it comes out of the skull base, it enters the deep portion of the parotid gland and travels through it, and then it comes out of the parotid gland and then supplies the facial muscles. After entering the parotid gland, the facial nerve initially divides into two branches, and then it divides into five branches before it comes out of the parotid gland, and then into multiple branches before it gets inserted into the muscle fibers. The facial nerve branches like a tree. No two facial nerve fibers are similar, and therefore patience and expertise is needed while doing the surgery to save the facial nerve. 80% of the parotid gland is superficial to the nerve and is called the superficial lobe. And most of the tumors arise from this because of the, it forms the major part of the parotid gland. Sometimes these tumors may develop from the deep lobe of the parotid gland as well. And when they are malignant, they can involve the facial nerve also. The skin incision is made in such a way that it may not be noticeable after surgery. The incision starts in front of the ear, then goes backwards underneath the ear lobe, and then comes down into the neck. The size of the incision can be reduced in smaller tumors. The skin is elevated so that we can expose the structures deeper to it, that is the parotid gland. Once the skin is elevated, we try to preserve the great auricular nerve, which gives sensation to the lower part of the pinna, that is the outer ear, and also the earlobe. Next is the most important procedure of the surgery. We have to detect the facial nerve when it comes out of the skull base, that is between the bone of the ear, that's called the mastoid bone, and also the parotid gland. And then trace the nerve and its branches by dissecting off the parotid tissue along with the tumor above the facial nerve and its branches. This is called superficial parotidectomy. If the tumor is small, we don't have to remove the entire superficial lobe of the parotid gland. We can remove the tumor along with a cuff of normal parotid tissue all around, so that we do not leave behind the tumor, and this is called adequate parotidectomy. In deep lobe tumors, we raise the superficial lobe of the parotid gland after exposing the facial nerve and its branches. Then we dissect the facial nerve of the deep lobe tumor. We free them of the deep lobe tumor, and then we resect the tumor involving the deep lobe without injuring the facial nerve and its branches. In this picture, you are seeing the facial nerve and its branches after removing the superficial lobe of the parotid gland. Facial nerve is being separated from the tumor, which is involving the deep lobe. The second picture taken after complete resection of the deep lobe tumor, the facial nerve and its branches were preserved. In malignant tumor, the entire parotid gland, both the superficial and deep lobe of the parotid gland, will be removed by preserving the facial nerve if possible. If the tumor is found infiltrating the facial nerve, that portion of the facial nerve will be resected along with the tumor, and then the nerve will be grafted. The skin is closed using plastic surgery techniques so that there is minimal amount of scarring. What happens if the parotid gland is removed? One, the patient need not worry about this salivary secretion because there's enough glands available which can produce sufficient amount of secretion even though the one of the parotid gland is removed. Number two, there will be a dent in the skin if most or entire parotid gland is removed. Therefore, we use a muscle graft or fat graft to augment this area so that the skin is smooth and facial symmetry is maintained. The patients are worried about the scar. As I mentioned before, with the proper positioning of the incision and also using closure with a plastic surgery techniques, the scar is barely noticeable after about a month or two. How do you achieve facial nerve preservation in parotidectomy surgery? It all stems from the knowledge of anatomy and also meticulous surgical technique. However, there are some technologies we use during surgery to make it safer. We use a special magnifying glasses known as loops, which will magnify the thin facial nerve fibers 2 to 3 times, and that makes it safer. We also use facial nerve integrity monitor, which will alarm us when we grow close to the facial nerve. And the third one we use is what's called the facial nerve stimulator. It gives electrical impulses, and using electrical impulses, it stimulates the facial nerve once it's exposed, and we can see the facial muscle contractions. That helps us to differentiate when we are in doubt between the nerve fiber and the scar tissue or a blood vessel. The type, grade, and the stage of the salivary gland tumor is essential to know before we can decide about the type of treatment. After the patient is diagnosed with parotid gland cancer, the doctor has to determine what kind of cancer it is. Stage of the cancer determines how far the cancer has spread, the size of the tumor, the involvement of the lymph nodes, and whether the tumor has spread to other parts of the body determines the stage of the disease. If the cancer is low grade, the patient receives only surgery. In high grade cancer, patient receives radiation in addition to surgery. In select circumstances, chemotherapy may be added along with the radiation in high grade cancers. Many salivary gland cancers can often be cured if detected early. Although curing the disease, that is cancer, is of prime importance, it is also necessary to make sure we preserve the facial nerve function. At the end of the treatment, we have to bring the smile back in the patient's face.